all, thank you to everyone joining this morning. I know many of you are joining from all around the UK and even some from Europe as well, which I'm quite happy to see. And I know I'm very much looking forward to hearing more about this talk myself. Just as a quick introduction, since I know we have many sort of first-time attendees to one of these events, this is what we traditionally would call a breakfast briefing by UserVision. We do them about every month or two. My name is Chris Rourke. I'm the CEO of UserVision, and we're a leading user experience and service design agency based here in the UK, but with clients in many places. And Gerry's going to be doing the talking today, but you can see our Twitter for UserVision and Gerry there if you'd like to mention it. And I was thinking I've started using hashtag just Earth Experience if you wanted to mention that with your views if you're a user of Twitter. Now, many of you, if you are familiar with the world of user experience, you'll be familiar with Gerry McGovern as the creator and main proponent of the methodology of top tasks. And that's certainly something that we're here at UserVision very strong advocates of as a really powerful way to align your website to what people are really wanting to do on your website and other digital channels and other channels in general, actually. And although we normally talk about something to do with user experience in these kinds of briefing sessions that we used to do in our office and are nowadays doing digitally, today we're talking about something different, not the user experience, but the Earth experience. And I think it's an interesting concept about that these things are actually quite related. So it's not vastly different between the user experience and the experience of on our planet. Now, like most people, I was pretty kind of ignorant about the environmental impact of digital, a couple of years ago. Somehow must have thought that it all happened by magic. And, it was totally benign. But Gerry brought this whole topic to my attention about, over a year ago when he was writing the book. I remember having a discussion, and it was very eye-opening about the numbers, the staggering numbers that I'm sure he'll be mentioning as he was writing his book, Worldwide Waste, which you can see came out last year. And in fact, while I'm mentioning it, we're going to have an opportunity for you to win a copy of the book. We're going to have a little competition at the end for taking part in the feedback for today's session. So just stick around and I'll tell you more about that. But just hearing about that made me much more aware of what can and should be done to sort of minimize the impact of digital on the environment. And that's really going to be the main point of today's talk. In terms of housekeeping, we're going to be here for about an hour and saved about 10 or 15 minutes for some Q&A sessions at the end. And so if you have any questions, please feel free to enter them into the chat area there on Zoom, and I'll corral them all together and do my best to get through some of these during our discussion at the end. But I think at this point, there's nothing more for me to say than I think it's time to hand over to Gerry to tell us some more about this fascinating area. Gerry.
Thank you very much, Chris. I'm just going to turn on my video just for a minute, just to say hello to everyone. But something that I'll be showing later that, ideas of how we can save, they're all small little things, but they all add up in the scale of things, particularly in larger organizations, that say an hour's worth of audio creates somewhere in the region of about 30 megabytes of data, whereas an hour's worth of video creates 300 megabytes. So essentially between audio, between not having video and having video, there can be a difference of 270 megabytes. And every megabyte that's transferred requires a certain amount of energy and creates a certain amount of waste. And it's all these tiny numbers that actually begin to add up over time. So I'm going to stop my video. So a concept that we're exploring with other clients is, starting off meetings with video introductions and saying hello and stuff like that. And then, maybe only the presenter or whatever using the video is going to audio to save the planet a bit. And actually, I think for a lot of us, it would be saving our sanity as well, because I'm not sure we want to constantly be on video all day long, all meeting long. But this sort of thinking, I think, all of these sorts of actions and behaviors can make a difference. So actually, Like Chris, I used to think digital was magic. So I was just a year or two ahead of Chris, so to speak. I don't know. I just used to think that it's digital. It must be green. You know, we're not printing out letters, you know, sending letters and stuff like that. No more paper, all that sort of stuff. Paperless office, digital automatically must be green. But as I dug into it and started doing some research, the biggest, scariest thing that I discovered was devices. Our devices, when you get your iPhone or whatever phone you've got, your typical smartphone will have already created 60 kg of CO2 in its manufacture. Electronics are very intense and resource intense and energy intense in their manufacturing process. So over the typical year of using a phone, you'll probably create about 5 kgs of CO2. So the majority of the actual pollution occurs during the manufacturing phase. And when you combine that with basically very short life cycles and very low recycling, you get a tremendous waste problem. So 54 million tons of e-waste every year is being created. To give you some sense of that, all commercial aircraft ever built would come to about 40 million tons. And basically, a lot of it ends up in places like this. We dump our e-waste in poorer countries, so we don't really see the problem. A lot of smartphones and electronics use rare earth materials. And a lot of those rare earth materials are by definition rare and are in places where the Western lowland gorillas actually live. And we are destroying those beautiful habitats of those beautiful animals and many other animals so that we can have these smartphones. I'm not saying not have smartphones, but there are certain lessons of, you know, how long we hold on to them. So 80% of CO2 created during manufacture. So the cardinal lesson, if you take anything away from today, is hold on to your digital devices as long as possible. And when you're buying, buy for longevity. Make sure you get the maximum warranty you can if you're a commercial manager. Really buy stuff that will last. Pay the extra few quid. It'll last a couple of years. It'll actually save you in the long term, and it will certainly save the planet. Less than 20%, and that's optimistic, is actually being recycled, because we don't design. And before this call, we were talking, Chris was talking about the, you know, the circular economy, and that people go, oh yeah, I know nothing about that. Well, that was the economy we used to have before digital. That was the old economy when we recycled glass, when most of the stuff we created, we reused, whether it was glass or steel. It's this newfangled economy that's not circular. We have in the last 50 years created a waste economy instead of an economy that we constantly recycle and reuse things. So this waste economy is a new economy. And by definition of waste is reusable, stuff that's reusable, toxic stuff that goes back into the water, poisoning the water system, etc., or just lays there without any benefit. So we've got the actual digital devices taking up, creating about 80% of the waste at the moment. Having said that, the demand for these devices is driven by data, and data is absolutely exploding. More data created in the last 2 years than in all of previous history. We're now into zettabytes of data. A zettabyte of data, if you were to print out a zettabyte of data, that would require 20 trillion trees, which is six times more trees than exist in the entire planet at the moment. So data is, and we're, by 2035 is estimated, we'll have over 2,000 zettabytes of data. What is so bad about this is that 90% of this data is crap. You know, it's never not used 3 months after it's actually stored or created for the first time. So we have this tremendous wasteful habits of creating, whether it's emails or PowerPoints or images or videos or whatever, that we don't even use. So we're digital has made us incredibly slothful in a way and lazy in our actual behaviors. And that's, in a way, the most dangerous impact of digital is digital makes it easy. Digital makes it easy to do stuff, easy to create stuff. It's the cultures that digital drives. We could not have fast fashion. And fast fashion next to the oil industry is the most polluting and damaging industry on earth. We are buying three, four, five times more clothes than we did 20 years ago, and we're using them half as long. Every second, there's a dumper truck of old clothes being dumped into the oceans or in unregulated dumps around the world, every single second. And the whole economy of fast fashion is extraordinarily exploitable because it's all based on, oh, it's only €5, it's only, you know, or 10 euros, I'll buy it and I'll wear it once or I'll wear it twice. But we could not have fast fashion without Instagram culture, without MacBooks. We've gone from two seasons a year in fashion to 24. You couldn't do that if you had pencil and paper and you were drawing your actual designs. So digital accelerates a lot of extremely bad, lazy human behaviors of cheap and easy and disposable convenience. So we really need to resist digital, almost like we resist sugar in the process. Digital is very alluring, but it creates really bad underlying habits in human societies. And we need to address those if we're going to save this planet. Because right now, digital is accelerating us more than any other thing towards a destructive climate breakdown. So Chris talked a little bit about the Earth experience, about this idea in waste, you know, going beyond obviously me at the say, we're not designed for us, you're not the user, the organization should not be the center of the universe. We thought we had got there with the user, but there's a bigger experience outside. You know, how does this affect the Earth? The decision that we make today that is at our convenience, is that going to cause 1,000 years of waste, either in plastic or in toxic type of materials, et cetera? What is the larger experience in play here? I think we need to start bringing these conversations to play. So the Digital Waste Audit looks at an organization from four basic aspects. The culture, because the culture is really what drives all this, like the Instagram culture, the culture of easy creation, the culture of where you move up through an organization based on what you create, not on what you reuse or maintain in the process. So websites, looking at websites, key drivers of the place, and the way we communicate. So I'm going to briefly work through some of these and some ideas. So the culture. So the positive cultures, and there are good signs of positive cultures, is that we are moving towards a more collective intelligence, collaborative, multidisciplinary sort of culture. And these sorts of cultures tend to be less wasteful. And I'll give an example why. So multidisciplinary science is better science. Many studies have been done on the most effective science that has occurred. So science that brings people together across disciplines. But equally, it's less wasteful, and I'll explain why. So teams, maybe messy getting teams going, but if it's done properly, teamwork rather than individual work and multidisciplinary cross-functional teamwork is a key driver of sustainability. So if you're pushing in that space, you're pushing in the right space. And if you're living within a silo-based organization structure, you're in all likelihood living within a very wasteful organizational structure. So a reward model that's beginning to emerge now, and Microsoft and others are trying to attempt this, that we traditionally reward people for what they create. So we have a so-called creative culture. You are what you create. You are what you produce. You are what you put up on the website. And if we're going to create a circular economy and a much better economy and less wasteful economy, we also have to start rewarding people for what they share. We need to motivate people not simply to create something and launch and leave it, but to actually share that thing that and that other people use it, whether it's a piece of code, whether it's a form or whatever. There needs to be a motivation within the organization that the person wants to share those things that they're creating with other employees or other stakeholders so that those stakeholders will not have to reinvent the wheel, so to speak. And also, another tier in this reward model is what you reuse, that we reward people to reuse things that other people have created, rather than this have this constant ego, career-driven idea that, no, I'm the new manager. How many stories have we got where the new digital manager comes in and they have to do a redesign? Because are we still like dogs, you know, walking up to trees and doing what dogs do in the new neighborhoods? I mean, come off it. Surely humans can progress a bit more than having to put your stamp on the digital environment every time you're a new digital manager by actually putting a new skin or a new surface on the environment. It's so archaic and such a pathetic actual behavior, and yet it drives so much digital activity in so many environments. This is the Norwegian Cancer Society, which we worked with in 2012. And we did a top task analysis with them to identify what do people really want to do. And surprisingly, people wanted treatment, symptoms, prevention. This is the sort of stuff they wanted to do. And what was at the bottom of the list that nobody was really voting for was all the donation type tasks. And the Cancer Society said, we're worried about this because how are we going to raise money if we're not constantly asking people for donations? But they decided to do something brave and to really adopt a top task approach. And at that stage, they had 5,000 pages and 45 people contributing content to the actual website. So they went to a much more professional environment where much less people, down to 6 people, but these people were now working together. Every week they were talking to each other, because if you got 45 people with only 10% of their time, they're not going to be talking to each other, sharing best practice, etc. You can't create quality without quality professionals. You cannot reduce waste if you've got massive distributed publishing in organizations. Massive distributed publishing in organizations is the ultimate recipe for dumping. So less people, higher quality, better trained. So they went from 45 people to 6 people in the process. And what they began to discover is as they started talking to each other, that they had multiple definitions of cancers. So the about cancer section had a definition of skin cancer, and the prevention section had a definition of skin cancer. And they had multiple definitions of this and that and multiple duplications, because they never talked to each other. They existed in their silos and they pumped out content through their silos. So they went from 5,000 pages to 1,000 pages. 80 to 90% of what you have if you're a normal organization is crap. On your website or on your intranet or whatever, it's just produced in a primitive manner to show that you're doing stuff. We need to start stepping back from that. And one of the first things that we should do is actually do an audit on how much content and data do we have. And I know very, very few organizations that have even the remotest clue of how much data or content they produce every month and how much content they have. So that would be an interesting place to actually start. And remember the Norwegian Cancer Society, whose tasks, their donation tasks were all at the bottom, and they took all the new website. It didn't say anything about donation. It just focused on the core cancers and treatment, etc. Well, their donations doubled because they were solving the problem. They weren't constantly flooding the space with needy calls for donation. They were actually helping people with treatment. So you solve people's problems, you simplify, it's good for the earth, it's good for the customer, and it's good for the organization. But sorry, it's not good for the ego of old-style managers. That's who it's not good for, and that's unfortunately where we live at this moment in time. Okay, devices. Hold on to your devices as long as possible. It's a perfect storm of waste if we've got high CO2 in manufacture and a low life cycle and low recycling. That is the most toxic, perfect storm of waste possible. So the longer we hold on to our devices in the water, lots of water, for every phone we buy, there's about 40 kg of rock mined in the process to get that material. All sorts of thousands of litres of actual water used as well. So the carbon footprint, so holding on to your phone for 5 years versus 2 years can have a huge impact, because it's pushing off the need to build and manufacture a new phone. So hold on to your stuff as long as possible. A key message. Turn stuff off. In the US, they estimate about 20% of an average electricity bill is consumed by what they call vampire power. It's devices that are on but are not being used. So if you've got, this is a study on desktops. If you've got a desktop computer on, and it should be reasonably equivalent in a laptop as well, and that desktop at maximum usage is consuming 200 watts of power, then even when it's doing nothing, it's still consuming 100 watts of power. If it's at 50% utilization, it jumps to 180. 100%, it jumps to 200 utilization. Turn stuff off. Put stuff to sleep. Make sure you get into a discipline at the end of every day that you turn stuff off. If it doesn't need to be on, it shouldn't be on. These are good habits anyway to get. We need to change our cultural habits. Digital has taught us extremely bad habits. We need to withdraw from all these bad habits that digital has taught us. Choosing, you know, the difference between, you know, the energy consumption of a desktop is hugely more than a notebook or a laptop. And the reason is that laptops are designed to be used for batteries. So they spend a lot more time creating energy efficient laptops, whereas they don't really care about desktops, and they just slap them together from an energy point of view. So the type of device that you choose has a huge impact. Basically, screen size has a the bigger the screen, the bigger the energy. You know, the heat that comes off screen, that's waste. You know, and that's wasted electricity, wasted energy in the process. How you transfer data has a significant impact as well. If you transfer data using 3G or 4G, that is massively more wasteful than if you use a wire. A wire is the most efficient way to transfer data. You mightn't think so. This is a study in Germany using video streaming, the amount of CO2 that was created. If you used fiber optic cable, 2 grams an hour, which is very little. Copper cable went to 4 grams, but at 3G, it was 90 grams an hour. So the way, basically, Wi-Fi is about twice as inefficient, et cetera. So Wi-Fi, 3G, Wi-Fi is roughly twice as inefficient as wired. But 3G is 15 times more polluting than Wi-Fi, 4G about 23, and this wonderful 5G is 80 times more polluting. So much stuff that has been created in the digital economy today is the ultimate in wasteful behavior. Bitcoin is a scourge on the earth and the behaviors. So digital has this nice PR sheen that talking about how it's saving the planet, but actually most modern digital technologies are far more destructive of energy and far more polluting than their equivalents were 10 or 15 years ago. Pollution, the way you store data can have a significant impact on energy. There are all sorts of different storage options. Basically, if you go for an archival option versus cool, hot, or premium storage is probably the equivalent of Dropbox. Premium storage can be 150 times more polluting than archival storage because of the design of the systems, the always-on type of nature of the devices, etc. So the methods of storage have significant impacts on the amount of energy actually consumed. Looking at websites, we should be ashamed of ourselves in websites. Like, websites have gone from 400 kilobytes in 2005 to 4 megabytes in 2020 without any real benefit. It's just multiple explosion of this, just bad design behaviors. It's not that websites have got particularly better. It's just they've gone massively bloated because of so much lazy design principle. One of the things when you're measuring waste in a website environment, this is Mozilla Firefox, is that most of the waste will occur on the user's device, not on the designer's device. And that's partly why websites have got so bloated, because nobody cares, because you don't see the damage that you're actually doing. Mozilla calculated all the CO2 that they were creating on an annual basis. Everything from, you know, making coffee in their offices, etc. This was done before the pandemic, to, you know, paying their designers to the light and heat. And they found that only 2% of the CO2 was what they created internally, and 98% of it was created by the people using their browsers, which makes sense. So the more people you reach, the more damage you're doing by big, heavy websites that are having a really negative impact on the planet. So by 2021, 82% of consumer internet traffic will be video. Video is thousands of times more damaging than audio. Well, hundreds of times in audio, and thousands of times more damaging than text in the process. So be very careful with your video. Video massively scales up the damage in comparison to other communication choices. Optimization of images. Images are the next. And, you know, properly, one of these images is 40% lighter than the other, and we wouldn't really know because, you know, they're properly optimized. So there's all sorts of optimization strategies of using images. And basically, think about your images. Don't try and avoid all these crap cliche images that actually nobody ever liked, you know, nobody will ever like in the future. So really question the use of, do we actually need this? Is it effective? And concepts like lazy loading, where the images don't load until the person scrolls down the screen. There are lots of techniques we can do to optimize the actual environment. JavaScript has grown, which is the engine, the computer code that drives a lot of websites. It has grown from 52 kilobytes to 370. So that doesn't seem like a lot in actual weight, but JavaScript is a programming language. And when it gets onto the user's device, it starts initiating activities and processes on that device. So that on average can take 27 seconds at 370 kilobytes to actually make that page usable on a typical device. On poorer people's device, people who have cheaper devices, that can be up to 27 seconds in the process. So all of this stuff is not just a tax on the earth, it's a tax on poor people as well. All of these bloated websites and these bloated design principles make it very difficult for people with expensive plans and cheap phones. Custom fonts, we all go crazy with, have increased by 850%. Most people can't see the difference. It's all about internal ego and splitting hairs in a lot of actual situations. So finally, communication. I was talking a bit about audio. Analog audio. If you make a call, an analog audio, about an hour's call, and your old phones, right? That would take about 3.6 megabytes. That would create about 3.6 megabytes of data. VoIP audio, or internet audio, is 27 megabytes. So this is progress. So much of the so-called progress we have today is actually destroying the planet. Just makes it convenient and more easier for us. The older technology, in many situations, was much less polluting than the newer technology. In the process. Standard video creates about 270 megabyte, 720 HD, about 540 megabyte, 4K video, which we can't even see on most devices, about 9 gigabyte, and 8K, which they're all screaming about, the 8K TVs and the 4K TVs, that we can't even see the difference. You know, the eye can't even notice this stuff. We're sold by so much bullshit today. An 8K TV will consume 36 gigabytes, in other words, 10,000 times more data and 10,000 times more pollution than an old style analog call. That's the world we're building today. We need to be aware of that sort of world. And that's why we've got a climate crisis, because digital is an accelerant of that climate crisis, whether in the cars or in other environments. So thinking about issues of, you know, sending emails, and these are certain calculations, maybe they're not exactly right, or whatever. This came from Tim Berners-Lee's brother, who has written a lot about these. But everything we do creates a certain impact in digital. So I'm moving through this quickly, so I won't have time for questions and stuff like that. But you know, so how will the audit be carried out? So we've looked at how to design. It'll be a certain amount of management style interviews, an employee survey, and particularly a website audit or an audit within the data environment. So there'll be a whole range of, you know, talking to, you know, general managers and IT managers and HR managers, etc., and getting a sense of, you know, what's the culture? Is there a multidisciplinary culture? How is collaboration spaces left to it? You know, what is the professionalism of the content environment? Looking at the underpinnings of the organization. So there's a whole range of questions around management and the culture that has actually been created. Then there's a survey with staff to kind of cross-check. Well, is this, you know, if the managers say, yeah, everyone's responsible for content, etc., you know, is that what staff think in the process? So a view into the world of the employees or the staff, you know, do they feel they're working within a multidisciplinary, cross-functional, collaborative culture? And, you know, if not, what are the barriers to that? And, you know, what about content and data practice and sharing and reuse and device usage and communication and communication behaviors in, do they feel they're getting proper training, etc., in the process? Because most of this stuff is never looked at, is never examined in most organizations. Then the website audit is quite a detailed technical audit using a whole bunch of tools. Look at page weight, download speeds, static versus database websites, anything where the waste could actually occur. Like things like bots. You probably are not aware, but there's a bunch of unwelcome bots constantly visiting, bad bots basically, visiting your web page. And every visitor to your web page consumes a certain amount of energy. So you can block bad bots and stop certain bots getting coming into your website. You know, everyone's going crazy at the moment for chatbots that are installed on your website. We did an analysis on a website recently of a chatbot, which was absolutely useless, as 95% of chatbots. Chatbots are little torture devices, where how do you really annoy people in the fastest possible time by having a chatbot that can't even remotely answer the questions that they're actually asking? Oh, but it's cool. It's kind of artificial ignorance driven. And the senior managers really love it because it shows us as a real progressive organization. Oh, could we possibly get away from this childish behavior of always needing the latest toy when it actually comes out? But when we were doing our analysis of this website, 30% of the energy per page was being consumed by this chatbot that nobody was using, because the people who started using it stopped actually using it. So these sorts of clever looking devices are often very energy intensive, and most of them are not just useless, they are counterproductive in relation to giving a good experience for the customer. So there's a lot of detailed analysis in the website audit. Happy to answer any sort of questions about it. And all of it will roll together into a rating, a digital waste rating from A, B, C, D, E. And you know, there'll be findings and recommendations. Hey, if you do this, you do this, you know, and hopefully then it'll be a model that can happen on an ongoing basis. And this is something that, you know, we're working together. User Vision would love to talk to you about if you're interested in actually participating or finding out more about in the process. But that's the basic talk. I think I've gone through it reasonably quickly, which, you know, leaves sometimes it might give people an extra 10 minutes at the end of it all. But we're very happy to take any questions about any issue. And I'll just hand it back over to Chris for a moment, and then we get into questions. So thanks very much for listening.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much, Gerry. That was fantastic. Some inconvenient truths to sort of revive the term that was very much in vogue about 20 years ago when we first became, you know, very aware of environment, I suppose, and, you know, recently. But yeah, definitely some inconvenient truths. And thanks for the suggestion someone gave me to do the little poll about people turning off their monitors at the end of the day. And it roughly works out four options there, whether or not you do it always, usually, rarely, and no, and hardly ever. And it works at about 25% on each, just roughly all around that. But yeah, and it's something, it's one of these things that we just blithely carry on and yeah, never think of it, just because, oh, in case an update happens and things like this. So I think it's great. I've got a few questions. I'm going to take a look into the chat, which has been quite active, and see if I can find some other questions in there as well. And we could even just put it on the audio as well. You can take yourself off mute and ask it verbally.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Easier that way. But before we get to that, I just want to, first of all, in case anyone has to leave, thank you everyone for coming along today. I'm sure it's giving you some really good food for thought on the impact of digital. And I'm also really glad that we discussed the audit. It's something that Gerry's been driving. We've been working with him on that to develop the audit service to help companies learn about their impact, organizationally down to individually on the environment and from their digital estate and activities. So we'll let you know more about that as that service. It's, you know, as Gerry's mentioned, it's something that's in development in the right sort of iterative way. Just a couple other points before you go. We're quite interested in your feedback on the talk, but also the topic. So we're going to be sending you shortly an email just asking for your feedback. And I mentioned about Gerry's book. If you can complete and return that feedback form, we will enter you into a little competition to win a copy of Gerry's book, Worldwide Waste. So that's a little motivator for you. And we would be really interested to hear what you think about the topic, the talk, and other such things. Finally, if you've enjoyed today's talk, please consider donating a little money to the Woodland Trust, which is a UK registered charity. And it's actually UserVision's company charity for 2021. We select a different charity every year, and that's this year's one, and I think appropriate for this topic. We've set up a Just Giving page, which we'll put in this email to you, to donate some money to the Woodland Trust, and that will be spent specifically on the planting of trees, which will be doing its bit of counteracting all the excess carbon, as you know. So there'll be a link to that Just Giving page in the follow-up email that you'll receive shortly. But aside from that, thank you all very much. Now, let's have a look at the questions. I guess I'll start off with the first question that may have struck some other people. This is, I think you've got a very bought-in audience that understands this, but where do you encounter resistance? Or I'm asking sort of two questions in one, I suppose, which isn't right, but do you encounter resistance to this message? And how do you overcome it when you're talking to organizations? Where does that resistance come from, and what's your best ways to overcome that?
Yeah, I suppose, there is a general resistance of that, there is the argument, oh, this is almost nothing, or a gigabyte is almost nothing, or, it's the almost nothing argument that comes out because, yes, on a gigabyte basis, it's very, very little in comparison to, say, driving a car or taking a flight. But it is in all the cumulative activities of the, I was reading a study yesterday that estimate there's 800 million phones in the European Union, sitting in desks, sitting in drawers, that are not recycled or 800 million, and that since 2007, I think we've created something like 12 billion smartphones manufactured, about 12 billion smartphones around the world. So it's all this hidden accumulation. And of course, the device manufacturer people don't see. So, they just see this seemingly cheap price for the cloud storage in the process. And I think it's this 20-year, 30-year, 50-year love affair, with cheap computing. That has created a real culture that doesn't want to, clean up after itself, doesn't want to document, that's just been fed on, the ability to just, launch it and trash it and then launch something else and trash that and launch something else. So it's a kind of and the sense as well, Chris, that you said that people somehow think they're special working in digital, that they're actually green. So, so there's a lot of delusion occurring in the actual environment. And, the people talk about, oh, we're using renewable electricity and everything like that, which is good. But, the electricity systems are coming under increasing stress. You know, as we use more and more electric cars, etc., the electrical architecture will not be able to deal with it. Even in Norway, they're beginning to ration and advise people not to use the plug in their car during 8 to 9 in the morning, etc., in the process, in these advanced economies. And there's a gas in electricity and electricity infrastructure called SF6, which is 23,000 times more polluting than CO2. So there's all these hidden, you know, but it's renewable. The renewable electricity still has to go across old-style electrical pylons, etc., in the process. So I think it's a waking up. Some people, you know, it may take them a year, 2 years. Some of them will never wake up. But most of them are like you and me, Chris, you know, having never really thought about this. So I think it's an educational process that hopefully we'll have less resistance as we educate more.
Mm, yeah, definitely. Actually, some interesting questions. There's one from Nicola Dokieka. And what struck me about this one, the resonant word there is duplicates, because I know I'm sort of guilty of this. Oh, where should we stick this document? This big PowerPoint, stick it actually maybe in two places just in case. And I think that's in essence in her question. Maybe Nicola, if you can take yourself off of mute, if you'd like to ask this question live.
Hey, thanks, Chris. I was thinking about a piece of work that I did last year, which revealed something quite surprising. It wasn't the initial focus of the work, but what it revealed was in a very large organisation, they didn't have any idea just how much duplication of content was happening. And it was as a side effect of the tools that they were providing to people so that they could work collaboratively. So it was coming out of something well-intentioned and well-meant and useful, very useful. But because they had, this organization had a very siloed way of working and very little central governance and very little adherence to what governance there was and little authority to enforce that governance, it was very, very difficult for them to say, if you are going to use these tools, you must not do X, Y, and Z. Because they couldn't enforce compliance, and they also had a culture where that kind of message would have just met with complete rejection. And the proliferation of content was absolutely immense. It was staggering.
Yeah, yeah. Well, Nicola, that you're talking about 9 out of 10 organizations there. You know, that's the behavior everywhere. That's the common behavior. That's not the exceptional behavior. And this is another big irony of digital. We're so terrified we lose stuff. We duplicate it multiple times. And then the data centers are so terrified they can't delete stuff that they're literally physically shredding perfectly good servers after 4 years, actually physically shredding them because you can't really delete content. So you can't keep content and you can't delete it. And it's the worst practices in both senses. Perfectly good servers, should last 7-8 with good maintenance, 7-10 years, are actually being physically shredded, put through shredding machines, the steel and the disks, just to guarantee that the data has been deleted. And then at the other side of the coin, everyone is so terrified that we lose stuff. You know, so all of these terrible behaviors are driven by digital technology. And it just accentuates toxic cultures of waste and duplication. And certainly one of the things you would be looking at in an audit for absolutely sure is the quantity of duplication that's actually occurring. And as I say, with the Norwegian Cancer Society, now, all types of duplication, multiple definitions of skin cancer, I mean, that's not good if somebody coming to your website is finding multiple symptoms of COVID-19 or stuff like that. I mean, many of the health websites are much more efficient, but you know, you can go to the European CDC, or certainly I went to it last week, and if you search for COVID-19 symptoms, you get a PDF in 27 languages that was published last February. Symptoms have changed since last February, but you know, nobody, there's no, it's a launch and leave culture, and you know, these are the organizations that are destroying the earth. I mean, it's not an accident that it's in the last 50 years that really global warming has taken off, because resource extraction, etc., has taken off. And in the last 50 years, the IT revolution has exploded. You know, I don't think it's a coincidence that these things have actually happened. And how we address them, it's, you know, this is 25 years going back, duplication. But, you know, the more of us raise these voices, maybe some sanity will come in. And maybe if we start bringing an argument that this is a wasteful, this is impacting negatively CO2, etc., maybe that might be the light bulb that will go off that could change behaviors.
Great. Thank you very much, Nicola, and for your question, and Gerry for your answer. Another interesting question from Jamie Ambler. Jamie, if you're there, if you'd like to maybe ask it live. I feel like a talk show host, but Jamie, are you?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
It's around the regulatory stuff. So I work for a bank, and we have to keep everything. I say everything, but have you any thoughts on making things data light in that perspective, where you have to keep kind of copies of bank statements going back 7, 8, 10 years or however long?
Yeah, and that's where, and I'm sure, as a bank, you know, you have those processes in place where archiving strategies are much less energy intensive than live accessible data. But I've worked with banks as well. And there's two worlds of data. There's the structured data, which is the regulatory, et cetera. And then there's the unstructured data, which are all the emails and the PowerPoint presentations and the, you know, all the other content. And there's a huge amount of that that doesn't need to be archived. That's just junk. And you don't need 70 versions of the management presentation of, you know, February the 7th, you know, and so there's a whole massive quantities of in the unstructured environment of stuff we could delete or find an archival strategy if we don't want to immediately actually delete it. So the structured stuff, you know, because that's always, you know, Jamie, we have to keep this stuff. Yeah, some stuff you have to keep, but most stuff you don't have to keep. It's just an excuse not to do the job properly and not to actually look at content and the massive reams of unstructured content that's actually being created that has no regulatory need to be actually kept in the process. So, you know, we can do this, and regulation is most unquestionably not an excuse for allowing toxic dumps to grow. So, yeah, we deal with the regulatory content in the way that it legally has to be dealt with, but there's massively other quantities of content that doesn't fit under that environment and is not being properly managed, either being archived when it should be and deleted when it should be as well.
Yeah. Gerry, just a quick question I have. Do you think there's any possibility that we might be able to motivate people to sort of self-regulate their behavior a bit to try and show that, okay, this image that I'm posting up on Instagram or whatever has been sort of, I've optimized it or something. And probably there's going to be a degree of, virtue signaling or something of people trying to say, look, I've done the right thing. And in a way, that's a good thing, you know, trying to say, look, I've tried to, in a similar way that people say, oh, look, here's a picture and I didn't use any filter. Okay, that's an Instagram thing. But maybe here's a picture that I've tried to, you know, do that. And what brought that to mind, I sent you that image of how on FaceTime, it lets you know at the end of your FaceTime talk, oh, that conversation used 1.6 megabytes of data or whatever. And in our very trackable of tracking how many steps we take, et cetera, kind of world we're in, that might at least plant the seed.
Absolutely, Chris. And, you know, that was what you sent me yesterday. Yeah, 27 minutes of FaceTime created 1.2 gigabyte of data. That's a lot of data. for a 27-minute call. And we need to develop tools and incentives. And, you know, everyone's trying to virtue signal. Luxury is circular. Everyone's trying to, every industry is trying to at least pretend that they're sustainable and that they're circular. And most people genuinely don't want to destroy the planet for their children and their grandchildren, you know, but they just don't feel that they're part of the process of destruction. It's somebody else that's doing it. No, but we're all doing it. I'm doing it. You're doing it. You know, the devices that we use in the process. But I'm not saying let's not have computers or let's not have smartphones. But I think if we eliminated waste out of, imagine if we didn't create that 90% crap that we don't use. We'd need far less servers. We could hold on to our computers far longer because we wouldn't be burning out the processor, the battery, etc. through usage. If we actually taught more, you know, digital teaches us not to think that it's all about action, it's all about agile, it's all about fast. You need to be sprinting. It doesn't matter if you're sprinting in the wrong direction once you're sprinting. You know, it's all about, oh, you got that app out in 2 months. That's what everyone wants to hear the story about. They don't want us to hear the story about the app that took 2 years to design. They want to hear the story about the app that took 6 weeks to design, because everybody is mad on cool, fast stuff. And cool, fast stuff is usually crap. You know, it usually has a shiny surface and then a horrible underside because it's actually stuck together without any thought. So any sort of techniques that we could use to educate and to help and to say, did you know that created 1.2 gigabyte of data? Instead of you having to go into the settings of that you would get informed as you're, you know, this call, if you do audio, it'll create blah. You could, you know, but unless we actually get back to the manufacturers over time and they see that consumers are changing, because they give us crap products because they think we buy crap and they think their clever marketing works. And it actually does. It worked for me. It works for most people for many years, that we're fooled by easy convenience and disposability. And waste is the business model of Apple. Waste is the business model of Samsung. The more we throw away our phones, the more money they make in the short term. So maybe their executives are going to get on the first plane to Mars, you know, when it actually lifts off, and they'll be all right. But we won't, and our children won't be all right. So, you know, we need to somehow change the economics of how we measure and visualize what we're actually doing on a day-to-day basis, and designing these triggers, as you indicate, of informing us along the way of how much energy we're consuming. I think any good designers on our technical people on this call can think of ways of doing that or integrating that into behaviors and calculating the total cost of this wireframe that we created, how many hours were involved in it, how much energy was consumed, and how much CO2 was actually created by creating this wireframe. And if we create 4 wireframes, how much extra CO2 will we create by doing that? And then maybe we don't need 4. Maybe we just need 1 more, or maybe we can work with this one.
Yeah, interesting. A couple more questions I think have cropped up. I've got Lizzie and then Annabelle. If you had a question about, I guess, comparing Lizzie Casmaran, maybe if you'd like to ask your question. It's I'll read it. How does the megabytes on FaceTime compared to if you'd actually gone to the meeting, you know, in an office, though, how would we, is it a net win or loss in compared to carbon emissions through traditional ways?
So definitely. Between, if you drove, there's no question. But, you know, people are actually, they did a study in the UK last year, before the recent lockdown, and they found that people were driving just as much as they had driven when they were driving to the office. They're just driving differently. So what you get is you get displaced behavior. We don't stop, you know, flying to the meeting. We may stop flying to the meetings, but then we fly more on holidays, on weekend holidays. So our behaviors are not changing. And in some senses, it's like the alcoholic saying, you know, I used to drink spirits, now I'm on beer. You know, like, you like, but beer is still bad for you if you drink a lot of it. So people are saying, oh yeah, but it's better than flying. Yeah, but it's still, you know, texting is still much better, or emailing is still much better, or not communicating at all is even better. You know, like a lot of the times, not having the meeting would be far better for everybody's health, the Earth's health, but we don't do that. We say, oh, listen, I'm not flying, so I can have 100, you know, video conferences, and I can watch 200 hours of Netflix, and I can leave the television on all day because I'm not flying. You know, that's not the behavior we should need. We shouldn't be saying, oh, but that's much worse. I could be drinking spirits. I'd have liver problems much earlier. Yeah, you're still drinking beer, you know, so, you know, we drink non-alcoholic beer. Try and constantly go to the least, you know, impactful way to walk across this planet.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks, Gerry. A good old beer analogy always resonates quite well, I think. Annabelle, I think you've patiently had a raised hand, so please let us know your question.
Thanks, Chris. Yeah, sorry, I don't have chat on my work Zoom for some reason. Thanks, Gerry. This is super interesting. I've just been thinking about, so I know a lot of organizations are setting sort of net zero targets, including the one that I work for. And you mentioned, I think it was Mozilla who had done a sort of review of all their carbon emissions and figured out how much of that was coming from sort of users on their site. I'm interested to know, in your experience, do sort of large organizations understand that if they're trying to reduce their emissions, this is like, it sounds like this is a hugely effective way to go? Or do you find a lot of kind of, you know, confusion still about that?
A lot. It's so early, Annabelle. It's really most, you know, most organizations that we're chatting with now say we've no clue how much data we even have. Mm. You know, I mean, does data create pollution? It's still like it's like discovering fire. You know, like it's still what is that part? So we're very it's very early in the conversation, and I think, you know, and just to say, anyone on the call, if you want to. A special one of these within your organization to present these ideas. I'm definitely willing and interested with Chris to organize and do that as well. So I think it's a real, we're in an educational phase for this period, and hopefully that, you know, it'll move forward quickly. But it's a struggle. But there's a general awareness that I think is, you know, of that the climate crisis is real and that we should do everything we possibly can do to avert it. So I think there's an openness to hear these that would be very deaf 10 years ago.
Yeah, it is. It's all about awareness. And I think things like this is definitely raising awareness, you know, where it's needed. Many of us were blithely sort of ignorant about the impact of this. You don't see the, you know, the gray smoke like you do coming out the back of a bus, or the piles of garbage floating around the middle of the Pacific or something. So we're sort of unaware of it. I'm just looking out for any other questions. If anyone does have a question, please feel free to just unmute yourself and jump in with your own kind of question or comment right now, if you'd like. Well, if not, then I've had tons of really good feedback and stuff you can see there in the chat. People really are motivated by this. You know, a lot of people would like copies of the video, and I assume we can share a link to the slides to Gerry.
Absolutely, I'll send you a link for the slides and absolutely.
Right. Okay, and we'll get that hosted up there, and great. Well, I think then that takes us to just pretty much exactly an hour, and I know everyone has really appreciated. As someone has just said, it's an amazing talk, and I think I'm really appreciated. I really appreciate your time, Gerry. on telling everyone about it. Everyone go tell your colleagues and friends about it.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's a great way to finish. I mean, be an activist. Yeah. We need to spread the word. If you believe in this stuff, do more research in it, but tell more people, please.
Yeah, that's it. Okay. Well, look out for the email. We'll be asking for your feedback. You could be the lucky one to win Gerry's book on worldwide waste. And otherwise, have a good rest of your day, everyone. And thank you again for joining us today. Thanks.
Thank you.